I assume CrowdStrike has some better procedures on rolling out updates.
They announced they've improved their quality assurance. They've improved their process for rolling out software. And they are trying to minimize their use of the Windows kernel. That last one was very fuzzy.
Yeah. So I think when something hits the mainstream as much as that did, I think anybody that's sort of playing in that space is going to be more cautious about it. So I think we're going to be in a bit of a bubble where people are just more careful until enough time passes that everybody forgets. But yeah, I think the root of it was pushing out a bad update, essentially. That's what really caused it. So they kind of pushed out zero instead of an actual valid set of signatures, and that was bad. So
I mean, obviously, you know, there's multiple routes here, right? When there's a disaster, we play the five whys question, right? Why did that happen? It's also the fact that they just in the first place had put out software that would just crash the computer if it ever got a zero when it didn't expect one. So question for the viewers. Do you think Windows should lock out third-party drivers like the Mac does? Because the Mac allows no third-party drivers. So this didn't happen on the Mac.
Yeah. I mean, it's...
Of course, that's why you can't get a USB Wi-Fi 7 card for your Mac, right? New version of USB. All the PC owners can go to Amazon, order a USB 3 card. It shows up, you know, often same day these days. And now your PC is up on Wi-Fi 7. Mac, there's no upgrade path. You wait till they come out with a new Mac, and then you buy it. You stop using your old Mac, and that's all there is. They do not allow drivers.
So in the news recently with the Tahoe, you know, the new macOS release, they removed FireWire support. So there's no FireWire drivers. And so people are looking, and they're like, well, I have, you know, Thunderbolt to this, and to FireWire, and it should work, right? And no, it doesn't. Even if you could physically connect it, there's no driver for FireWire. So even if you have the stuff to connect it up, it just doesn't work, and there's no path. So it's just a bunch of people with devices that they still like that they just can't use because there's no driver support, never will be.
Yeah, and you can't even add it yourself, right?
Yeah.
If you're willing to do the work, too bad. Ryan wishes we could use USB Wi-Fi adapters on the Mac. Me too. So a lot of comments on those videos we did said, well, I can lock down the drivers on Linux. That's just as good as the Mac.
Right. So, I mean, a lot of this really comes down to CrowdStrike. I mean, it doesn't ship with Windows. Like, everybody that was affected by this, they didn't, you know, unbox their machine from HP and it's got it on there. And it's, you know, they chose, you know, somebody said, this is a good product we should have. It's going to make us more secure. Let's roll it out everywhere.
Right. And so they installed it on their computer, right?
Right.
Windows, you know, put up that UAC, you know, it made them, are you sure you want to do this? And they said yes. Which means that if you lock down your Linux kernel, you would have been convinced to unlock it for them.
Right. Right. Yeah. And I think there's enough compliance and stuff where people, you know, managing big fleets of Linux devices have, I've seen, you know, a lot of times there's multiple security agents running on there and they're watching everything and they're controlling AppArmor profiles and they're locking down the firewall and they're responding to, you know, new threats in real time. And that really means that their signature is being sent down. And so the same thing can happen there. I mean, you can have a big fleet of Linux machines where all of a sudden you get a bogus set of AppArmor profiles and you're locked out. You gotta walk around and start plugging in USB and VGA cables to a bunch of servers because you can't access them anymore. That same thing can happen to Linux. I mean, we're putting trust in these security agents, and so sure, the same. You're not going to get a blue screen of death on a bunch of Linux machines, but you can absolutely be locked out.
We're a few weeks away. You're not going to be able to get a blue screen of death on Windows either. So did you hear? So Microsoft just like in the last 3 weeks, rushing to get them out before the 1 year anniversary, have put out, you know, three fixes for testing. They're not out yet, so you don't have them unless you're on developer previews. One, they've added a new API for security vendors. So that stuff like CrowdStrike can do what they need to do without actually being in the Windows kernel. Two, they've added a new feature they called QMR. If Windows crashes several times in a row when trying to boot, it stops loading third-party drivers and comes up and tells you, oh, there was a problem, and only goes to the Microsoft drivers, so you have a chance to uninstall whatever was breaking it. So then you could get out of it, right? The problem is people were so stuck, they got blue screens of death so instantly that there was no way to get out and fix it. So now they'll make sure you can get out and fix it, which is a change a long time coming. And the third fix, the blue screen of death is now black. So no one will ever get a blue screen of death again. Problem solved, except that black starts with the same letter. So it's still a BSOD, a BSOD. They didn't really, you know, I don't know what the point is. Oh, this is, you know, rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. It seems so mockable that they really shouldn't have done it, would be my stance. Own it. Ryan asked, does Speedify access the kernel?
So in order to operate like a VPN, we need to use the right driver for that sort of device. So on Linux and Mac, we have access to nice system level ton devices, and so that's what we use.
Which is to say the kernel already comes with a driver.
Exactly. Yep.
That Linux and Apple approve of, so we just use it.
Yep. And on Windows, we use a Speedify virtual device adapter driver, which is kind of derived from OpenVPN stuff. So kind of pretty standard stuff that's been around for a long time. So yeah, we kind of do. But for the most part, we're using built-in drivers for that.
Did you guys hear about the ongoing Windows SharePoint server hack?
Yeah, that's bad.
Yeah, it's apparently really bad.
Yeah, and it's the sort of organizations that are still running self-hosted SharePoint that would be susceptible to this are the kind of organizations like local governments and probably don't really have much of an IT staff that can jump on this. And 20 minutes after the news comes out, they can go and patch stuff. I mean, local governments usually don't work like that. Whoever set up their self-hosted SharePoint.
I mean, I'm a day behind on this story, but as of yesterday, Microsoft still didn't have a fix, right?
Right.
I don't know if they do yet today, but given that it took them 11 and a half months on the CrowdStrike stuff, I have my doubts.
Yeah, it's got to be bad.
Yes. They put out a patch for the SharePoint flaw a few weeks ago that it didn't actually fix it. Classic. So that was all very fun. Now, I see a few people are starting to ask some questions here. Do you consider adding IPv6 multicasting to discover other devices running Speedify automatically and acting as a mesh? With parent share, do we use IPv6? I don't remember. With our parent share, we absolutely are using multicasting to discover other devices running Speedify and let them share their cellular connections back and forth. I think we basically do this already. I don't remember if we use IPv6 in there or not. A lot of the IPv6 stuff, we implemented it. All these people were asking us for it 3 years ago, and so we made sure it all worked great. And then nobody wanted it. We put it back on the shelf. You know, there's so many websites that just don't work over IPv6. GitHub. GitHub's not IPv6 yet.
Slack.
I mean, we literally can't work. I mean, we can't do work here on just IPv6.
Yeah, that's IPv6 only. There's just a lot of stuff. And yeah, a lot of stuff on AWS, things that people have that. If you're IPv6 only, you just can't access things that you would bet a dollar that it wouldn't support it, and it just doesn't.
Yeah, and last year when that backbone company declared they wanted extra money from Google to connect them on IPv6, and Google said no, and so just half the world on IPv6 couldn't get to Google for a couple weeks. Which just goes to show that they're like, if it went a couple weeks without the government having to step in or something, it means nobody cares. It's not worth anything. You shouldn't be paid for it, right? It's of no value. We have IPv6 support. And obviously with all the proxy stuff, we use it fully, all the local connections, everything locally.
Yeah.
We support it. But sorry to say, it's actually not ridiculous. It appears the industry has decided to skip IPv6. I think the people who implemented it kind of regret it. I think companies like Cloudflare and stuff are leading the charge and shifting us to a name-based system away from an IP-based system where you can have millions of names sharing the same IP address or the same group of 50 IP addresses, and that therefore the extra address space is not nearly as important. I mean, obviously, they don't care about peer-to-peer stuff. Peer-to-peer stuff has suffered badly. But it's one of these funny things that because you can't do peer-to-peer stuff anymore, everyone's kind of forgotten about peer-to-peer stuff. And nobody's asking for it. You know, maybe if IPv6 really took off, people would remember that once upon a time they were able to Napster-style send things directly between computers. But right now, everyone's used to you just drop it in Google Drive and the other person grabs it from there. Or Dropbox or email or Slack or all these things run through something else. It works well enough. Man, I was once so excited about IPv6. Sad. I don't know what they could have done. It's easy to say they screwed up the rollout, but increasing the address space, there's no way to do that that's compatible, right?
Right.
That's the one thing you can't. I saw an interview with Vincent Cerf where he's just like, I went to the whiteboard and wrote 32 for the number of bits next to the address, and no one said anything, so it was 32-bit. He said, if anyone had asked, are you sure that's enough? I would have changed it to 64. Nobody. He's like, no. He said, no thought went into it. Like, we were setting the packet structure. We had to decide how many bits. I wrote 32. No one said anything. We kept going. And that's it. That's why it's 32-bit. He's like, I don't care. you know, wouldn't have done 128-bit, right? That's crazy. But 64, sure, you would have done 64. Why not? You know, which it's a weird question with history, which things needed to be, which things were going to work out that way no matter what, which things are just somebody pulled it out of the air. I mean, there's going to be a network of networks, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But how much did it have to look like this? I think it had to look pretty close. I think there were a lot of thoughts about putting more intelligence in the network and all the features that would have given you. But I think it's clear all of those things turned out to fail, right? Because you ended up locked into 64-bit audio, 16-bit audio or 12-bit audio, whatever you thought was the right way to do audio in 1984. And then when better audio things came out, you'd be like, oh my God, we need to change IP now. That would have killed it. It would have lost to something dumber that just moved data packets. I think we were going to end out just about here.
Yeah, I think so.
Cam Vinny says, Speedify rocks. I use Wi-Fi and 3 phone hotspots. I never go offline. Nice. I love hearing that. What is the best and most cost-effective way to use your service? Combine Starlink and a MiFi 5G hotspot to a live streaming setup. The setup is running through a Slate 7 mobile router. You can put Speedify on the Slate 7 mobile router. Or if it's really just one PC you're trying to get online, you can, PC or Mac, you can put Speedify on it and have the connection to the MiFi and the connection to the Starlink both going to that computer, and then Speedify can bond it from there. It's probably the most cost efficient. It's just one computer you need online. Jay says, I have a few Mevo cameras and iPad connected to the Slate 7 mobile router that normally just streams to the app. Game changer and controlled with the Mevo multicam app. Yeah, so Mevos need a router, right? A lot of trouble. Mevos have this reputation for being really easy to use, but I tried to use them the other day. And I'll be honest, maybe I'm just dumb. But I had a lot of trouble with their app and stuff. Yeah, so it sounds like you want it on the Slate 7 so that a whole bunch of things, a whole bunch of different devices can get online. There's a variety of plans, including one that's a little bit cheaper with the 75 gigabytes a month for $129 a year. That might be your best bet. All right. My Speedify tells me every week how much traffic the app saved. What does this actually mean? So saves mean one of a couple things happened. Either one, your main internet stopped working when you were in the middle of doing something, and we successfully moved your traffic to another connection without breaking the sockets. So your stream continued even though your internet connection failed. Another is if for some reason you needed more bandwidth, like your internet connection slowed down, and we managed to bring in another connection to get you up to hit the speeds that your app needed, that also counts as a save. Oh, excessive packet loss or jitter. If the internet connections start becoming unreliable, we'll start spreading across multiple connections to avoid that, even if it's not a complete break. What CPU platform Speedify supports?
Really, x86 and ARM. Really,
64-bit x86, right?
Yep. I mean, x86, 64, so Intel and AMD, you know, regular desktop and laptop chips, and ARM, particularly like 64-bit ARM stuff for embedded and Linux and Mac.
Yeah, we actually did port to the MIPS devices, but they're just not fast enough to do the things we want to do.
Yep.
So having a Speedify that can only go 10 megabits, you called this Speedify. I think we're reaching the point where it's just, oh, never mind. It's ARM and 64-bit x86. What is your daily traffic? How do you deal with DDoS attacks?
So let's see. I mean, it's, I don't know, tens of terabytes a day or something. I think it's been a while. I don't remember offhand what the daily traffic is right now. So DDoS attacks, deal with that a few different ways. I mean, a fair amount of that is just having a large number of servers. I think the most common sort of DDoS that we see are people that are playing games through Speedify, and then somebody they're playing against hires a booter service or something. I mean, so basically a hired DDoS to knock them offline. Those can take down, you know, an individual speed server for a few minutes or 15 minutes or an hour or something, I mean, depending on how that goes. So having enough speed servers that everybody can move over if that does happen is important. Again, that happens maybe a couple times a month, not a super frequent thing, but that does happen. And for a lot of our web assets, we have things behind Cloudflare. And so we're able to mitigate and filter things that way.
So what is new with Speedify? I mean, you guys are busy working on all sorts of stuff.
Yeah, so there's a release coming up soon here. The big thing we're testing is jitter buffer. So I think we've talked about it a little bit in previous weeks, but adding the ability to kind of add varying delay so that, you know, your end-to-end latency is always the same. So I know there's video streaming devices and video streaming protocols that really don't like any sort of jitter in there. And so if you're combining things like 4G with Starlink, and you all of a sudden you plug in Ethernet, and you've got, you know, 100 milliseconds difference between your lowest latency and your highest latency connection, and you kind of want to use them all, you know, being able to streamline that stuff and deliver everything with the same latency can make a big difference for some protocols. So we are testing that. That should be rolling out in the UI soon.
And we've also got the single connection speed test coming up. And on Linux, this will be an exclusive feature of the Miri routers, where, you know, of course, we have the speed test now where you can test your bonded connection, see how fast it is or how good it is for live streaming. Well, now you can go through one connection at a time and try to figure out how fast each one is by itself, which is a frequently asked question from professional streamers who often use devices like the Miri router. It's a fantastic router if you guys haven't seen it from Miri Technologies. It has 4G and 5G modems built in. It has Wi-Fi. It has 4 Ethernet ports, any of which can be uplinks or downlinks. It has USB ports where you can tether Android, iOS, a wide variety of 4G, 5G modems. So you can end up with 9 internet connections on this thing. And it uses NPF batteries. So sort of standard batteries that a lot of cameras and stuff use. Ring lights. I've seen ring lights that use them. So you might well own this battery already. Pop it in. There's actually a lot of fixes for parent share coming. So parent share, of course, is the crazy system we created where your iPhone, your Android can share their cellular with other devices running Speedify on the same network. So if a main internet connection goes out, main internet connection gets too slow, the other devices, including potentially your router running Speedify, can reach out to your phone, borrow some cellular, bond it into the connection. So I think we tracked down some issues where if you get it all hooked up and then put everything away and then set it up the next day, the parent share sometimes wouldn't magically reconnect. I think we figured all that out. So just makes a little bit more magical. They find each other again with no effort on your part. Anything else we're supposed to talk about here, Brian?
Still working through self-hosted server stuff. I think we'll have internal demos of that this week and hoping to get that out to everybody soon here.
Yeah, that'd be nice to be able to host your own server. Yeah, we have a few people we've walked through setting it up, but it's been so much work for both them and us that we put a pause on it to smooth out this process. I know another thing that's coming, Kevin's not here today, but he did a lot of more work on, VSATs, internet connections where you're hitting a geosynchronous satellite and seeing a second of latency. Squeezed a little more performance out. Still 1 second latency, right? There's no miracles here. So here is Speedify. We are using Speedify right now on this Mac Mini M1 in front of me. So we have Ethernet going to a Comcast cable modem. We have Wi-Fi going to the same Comcast cable modem. That's not really going to give me any fault tolerance. And then I've got my tethered AT&T iPhone, which does give us some redundancy. By the way, you can change the color of these things if somehow you've ended up with the same color for every connection. So right now we're just using the Comcast because it's working fine. Oh, no, wait, I was on the wrong graph. We are not.
I'm streaming, yeah.
We are streaming redundantly. It is not happy. So it's using all the connections, right? So we're going over both Comcast and, because there's so much packet loss on the Comcast. That's not great. But anyway, so Speedify is protecting us. So this would be a very choppy stream. All right. Thank you, everybody. This was really good. Good to hear from you guys. Thank you, Brian. I know you are super busy. Sorry to drag you away from all the things you do. All right. So thank you, everybody. If you have more questions, you can check out our knowledge base at support@speedify.com or send us an email at support@speedify.com and we'll be happy to get back to you. We make our engineers live stream every Wednesday. So subscribe if you want to ask them your tech questions.